I don't know what God got in store for us on today, but I want to encourage you to put your hands together and receive the shepherd of this house, the pastor, the angel, Bishop Ronald Demery Jr.
Come on, somebody help me praise the Lord. Come on, let's give him praise. He's worthy to be praised. Come on, the Lord is here. I said the Lord is here. Hallelujah. Just hug somebody and tell them I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord. Yes, I'm glad to be here. So glad I'm here. So glad I'm here in Jesus' name. He didn't have to let me live, but I'm here. Hallelujah. God bless you. In the name of the Lord, we thank God for being here today. Thank you, Pastor Brian, for that beautiful introduction. Let me honor the Lord for our apostle in his absence, Apostle James Silver. Let's praise God for him. Mother Vera Silver, amen. Come on, let's praise God for them. Certainly, we thank God for First Lady, amen, who will be celebrating 43 years of life tomorrow with her twin, LaJuan. God bless you, amen. Certainly, we thank God to Assistant Pastor Franklin Jenkins, amen. To all of our associate pastors, Pastor Bryant, Marshall, Whitehead, amen, Jenkins and their wives. Let's praise God for them. God bless you. To all of our elders and ministers, missionary saints of God, board of trustees, we thank God for you today. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. And I don't want to be too long, but I thank God for being here. I want to thank God for this choir. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Certainly you have ministered to us today. Amen. In the name of the Lord, and we thank God for you. Where's my son? Stand up, James. That's my son, James. There. He is 16 today. Amen. God bless you, and happy birthday, son. Amen. Today, they said, sing to him. Yeah, him and Minister Russell's birthday is on the same day. Happy birthday, Jim. God bless you. All of those that are celebrating birthdays this week, we thank God for you. But he's a special young man. We're so very proud of him. Amen. He's 16 today, and he's driving me around now. He's a good boy. He really is. God has blessed him. He's just earned a 4.2 GPA. Amen. I just want to share with somebody today the blessing. I guess when he was about in the third grade, his teacher called us and told my wife and I, she said, please allow him to go to a special school for tag. She said, he's gifted. And she said, I'm telling you, he will be able to write his own ticket. And amen. And so we allowed him. We were at first a little reluctant to do it because the school was out of our zone, not close to our house, and we didn't want him far away. Amen. But the Lord told us to let him go, and he's been excelling ever since, and God has blessed him, and so we're very proud of him. Amen. And all of our children, even little Art, she got a 4.0 on her GPA. Amen. And Anaya, she's doing well. She's a sophomore at Bowie State. God is good. And so we thank God for the blessing. If it had not been for the Lord on our side, we don't know where we would be. So we thank God. I thank God for my entire family, amen, that's here. We thank God for you, amen, in the name of the Lord. And I thank God for our Bible Way family. We appreciate you, and we love you with the love of the Lord. Now, I don't want to be too long today, but I got a word for somebody here. I got a word for somebody here today. But I want you to remember to please pray. for the bereaved families. Seems like we've been dealing with so much death over the last couple of weeks, and certainly we need to pray for the bereaved families. You've heard it, those that have passed on. But one thing that was not in the bulletin was Sister Mary Stewart's mother, and her service is this coming Wednesday in North Carolina. And Sister Petty was talking last night. I think some of them want to go. So if you're interested and you want to go, amen, Sister Petty, if you can see her, we're going to try to work out a way. I think she's going to try to take some people down that want to go to the service on Wednesday. So let's pray for Sister Stewart. And her family and all of those that have lost loved ones, amen. Let's pray for them in the name of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Now, listen, just very quick. We have a testimony. Amen. This morning we have a testimony. Amen. And Sister Wilda Budd. Amen. I'm going to give her 2 minutes. Amen. Amen. I'm going to give her 2 minutes. But we thank God for her. She was ill. And thank God she's back with us. Let's give her a hand. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Praise the Lord, everyone, and good morning. I'm humbled, amen, to have this opportunity to share, amen, how good God truly, truly is. Amen. And truly today of all days, amen, to share how the love, amen. It's all right to talk the talk, amen. But here in this house, right here in Bible Way, amen, I found people who walk the walk, amen, the walk of love. If you say you know God and can't love nobody, what you said this morning, that's glory to God. Hallelujah. But I am a living testimony, a living witness, amen, of how good God is. Well, I've only been here a very short time, 3 years to say. And when I first came to Bible Way, I was going through chemo and radiation, amen. I praise God, amen, that I am a cancer survivor. I give honor, first of all, to our servant leader, Sister Carlene Roy, amen. Extraordinaire, praise the Lord. Amen. Honey, would you send this back there to her for me? Sister Carlene, raise your hand. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Giving honor to God and my pastor. Amen. Even my husband is here today. Amen. That's a testimony in itself. My marriage ain't nothing what I want it to be. But praise the Lord, if you just continue to believe God and keep your mouth off of it. Amen. Let God do what he got to do. And this morning, amen, my husband is in the house. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. So praise God, being a cancer survivor, praise the Lord, I am blessed with some lung issues. And I was in the hospital because of that. And praise God, I'd been there about three, four days. And I kept saying, Lord, ain't no, I finally felt like getting up out of the bed. And I said, Lord, ain't no prayers in this room, amen. Ain't nobody called me, I ain't heard a word from my soul. I was standing in the window and all of a sudden I turned around and who would I see? None, amen, but our own Pastor Whitehead. Hallelujah. God answered the prayer just like that. Just like that. In come Pastor Whitehead, who prayed heaven down over me. Okay? And then left me in the room dancing and shouting and leaping for joy. Hallelujah. I was praising God so bad, amen. In come the man from a breathing treatment. I said, man, you better hold on because I got to praise my God right now. Right now. And after that, you can give me the treatment. Hallelujah. So, Pastor Whitehead, hallelujah, left me there shouting and dancing. And that wasn't all of it. Didn't you thought I was crazy? They even had the nerve. God bless you, pass that back. They even had the nerve to send a psychiatrist in. Says, there must be something wrong with this lady, amen. I said, sir, ain't nothing wrong with me. You just need to know my God. If you knew my God, you'd be shouting and screaming and dancing just the same. Hallelujah. All right, then the very next day, I was feeling bad. My blood pressure was going up, 187 over 102, 198 over 102. Amen. I kept telling the nurses, something is wrong. This medication that you're giving me is raising my blood pressure. They wouldn't listen. So I sent my grandson home, amen. Said, Jeremiah, go home and go get my medicine, because I'm going to take me some medicine. All right, so I did that the first night. I went in and it went down. I felt better. Praise the Lord. But the second night, they caught me doing it. He says, Ms. Bud, you cannot do this. You can't take your own medicine in this hospital. You can't do it. We're asking that to say, okay, praise the Lord. I'm going to be obedient. Amen. They say it's better than sacrifice. So I was obedient, didn't take my medicine. Lo and behold, my blood pressure went up 229 over 112. couldn't raise my left leg, Jesus. I felt I could barely raise my left arm. I hit the button. I said, ma'am, something's wrong. Something ain't right here. Next thing I know, amen, she came and took my pressure, 229 or 112. Next thing I know, I heard this over the loudspeaker, a cold stroke. I didn't really pay any mind because I was on a telemetry ward where you hear that all the time. Next thing I know, in come all these doctors and nurses coming busting in. Miss Bud, do you know your name? Where are you? Can you tell us how old you are? All those kinds of things. Can you lift your arm? And I realized, oh my goodness, I'm having a stroke. In the name of Jesus, Miss Bud, calm down. We think you may be having a stroke. We're here in the hospital and we can take care of you. Amen. So immediately, I love technology. Praise God. In my smartphone, I set up groups, and I have a group that's called the Prayer Warrior Group, amen, and they got about 10, 12 people in there, so immediately I hit the button, they call them a cold stroke, amen, anybody in here got that email, did you get it, amen, some people got that email, praise the Lord, pray right now, because they called them a cold stroke, amen, they were pushing me down the hall to the seat to take a CT scan right quick, you know, do it all very fast when it's in the hospital, because you only have a very short time when you have a stroke, so the blessing is that it happened while I was in the hospital, hallelujah. Amen. But see, God had already set it up. The Pastor Whitehead had already came and believed and prayed the prayer of faith and healing over me the day before. Amen. So the devil still didn't have nothing to work with. So we praise the Lord. And as I was going down, so the very first in 2 seconds, immediately Sister Farmer, praise the Lord, who's not here today, amen, immediately called. And I could answer the phone. I was rolling down the hall, and she just started praying. I said, keep on praying. Don't stop praying. And she didn't stop. Okay, I finally said, change beds. Got to the CT room. They changed beds. They pushed me in there to take the CT scan. Came out. I could still hear Sister Farmer praying, okay? She was still praying. She didn't stop praying. I changed beds. She still was praying. She and I prayed all the way back to the room. Next thing I know, then, praise the Lord, Sister Shirley Wallace, hallelujah. Pastor that back to Shirley Wallace. God bless you. Love. People, I'm talking about love. Okay, Sister Farmer and Shirley was on the phone. We were praying and praying. Believe in God, hallelujah. Then my oldest sister, amen. I had the Father, I had the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Out of 12 people in that group, only 3 people responded to the email, to the text, hallelujah. Fathers, oh God just covered it all. He covered it all. And they prayed and prayed and prayed. So as we were praying, in come a cleaning man. The cleaning man went over, because I was in a two-person room, went over to the other side, turned the TV all loud, so couldn't nobody hear. I said, sir, I can't hear the prayer. You remember that? Sincerely, I couldn't hear the prayer, because he was mad. I mean, he was mad. That was the devil. Amen. But God always takes it the bad and turns around for your good and his glory. So the nurse said, don't worry about that, Miss Bud. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to move you across the hall and give you a single room all by yourself. Hallelujah. I was in a private hospital, glory to God, in a private room. Oh, I said, thank you, Jesus. See, the devil didn't have no hope at all. Fooling with me, amen. Should have got me when I was out there. Glory to God. Amen, amen, amen. All right, hallelujah. But then, okay, didn't come time, praise the Lord, the next doctor came and had to take the EKG. All right. She was praying, and my sister was saying, well, who's there with you? I said, I'm here by myself. Ain't nobody here with me right now. But I said, no, you're talking wrong. God said he'll always be with you. He's right there in the bed with you. So as I looked up, here come another white coat coming in. I opened up my eyes. You never guess who it was. Brother Robert Church. Hallelujah. Stand up, Brother Church. Are you here today? Hallelujah. This was my man who did my EKG. Oh, glory. Look at here. He could have lost his job. He didn't even do the EKG. He put the thing down, grabbed my hand, and together we prayed. Hallelujah. And we believed God together. Hallelujah. So God was with me in that hospital. Oh, glory to his name. Brother, come on to this, Brother Church. Oh, hallelujah. I'm talking about love, y'all. Come on here. This is what I'm talking about. God is love. Yes, he is. But he works through people. Okay. Hallelujah. So finally, praise God, after we prayed, about 10, 15 minutes, hallelujah, I finally let his hand go, because I'm going to tell you the truth. That spirit of fear was all over me, okay? Good Bible tongue talker that I am, okay? I have to confess, amen, I was some kind of scared, all right? When you're scared, say you're scared. But I called it, but I had backup. Plenty of backup. People right here in this house who don't know me from a can of paint, hallelujah, they were willing, hallelujah, to just love on me, amen, in spite of, because I'm different. I know I'm different, Bishop. I'm just a little bit different, amen. But I just got to declare unto you, if you just try the Spirit, by the Spirit, you'll find that there's power in diversity, and we're on the same team. Glory to God. In the name of Jesus. And finally, praise the Lord, when it's time for me to be released, I said, Lord, how you gonna let me go home? I ain't got no money to even get the cab home. Amen. Ain't got no money to buy no Christmas gifts. All of a sudden, a young lady called who didn't even know I was in the hospital, Sister Yvonne, sitting right there. Glory to God. You hear me? While the doctor was saying, no, Miss Bud, you got to go out of here. I got to release you. You got to go. I said, she said, don't worry about it, Sister Wood. I got you. I get you medicine. I get you some food. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Then the next time I got home, I was so tired. Amen. I couldn't fix no food. Next thing I know, he come here next. The next that Sunday, Sister Gloria came. She's not here today. God bless her. She's not here today. Amen. She came and bought me soups and things of that nature and blessed me there. Then someone else came to my house, helped me clean up what I've been gone for a whole week. Amen. Hallelujah. God just covered every point there. Every sport. And I just want you to know, and if you keep on walking with him, if you keep on believing him, hallelujah, he'll do it. I'm a living witness that he'll do it, that his word is true, hallelujah. And if you don't got to be perfect, you ain't got to be. Just trust him, amen. Just keep on believing him, and he'll do the rest, amen. God bless you all. Hallelujah.
Come on, let's pray. Father, in the name.
Please let me honor those who, one more person, Sister Marcine Harrison, don't you dare sit down, amen. The encouragers sometimes need to be encouraged, amen. And Sister Marcine, God bless you, Lord, for you. Give her that. And the Lord for you, amen. And we bless God for you. And Brother Jimmy, wherever you are, this is for you. Happy birthday.
All right, amen. God bless you.
Now, you got any more chocolate in that bag?
Let's give her a hand. Isn't that a powerful testimony? Come on, somebody give God praise. Come on, she's here today. Come on, somebody help her praise God. God bless you, Sister Bud. God bless you. Listen, real quick, I promise you all, I don't plan to be long. Just hold your seat for a moment. Amen. Thank God. Amen. For that powerful testimony of what God has done for her. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Now, listen, we've been talking the last couple weeks, and I'm excited about what God is doing in Bible Way. There's some great and exciting things coming. Let me commend Sister Lifford, those that were part of the singles ministry on yesterday. Thank God for her. God bless you. I heard that was a great success. And we thank God we were here yesterday. We understand, amen, that the financial principals had a session on yesterday. And stand up, Sister Tasha, and your team. Amen. And we thank God, amen. Now, those of you that don't know, I believe it's every second Saturday, they meet here. Those of you that need help with your finances and to learn how to create a budget and all that stuff, you need to be here. Amen. For these sessions, God gave us these ministries not just for us to have them as an icon on our website, but God gave us these ministries to affect change in the lives of the believers. Amen. And if we don't take advantage of it, we have these gifts right here. These are professional people who God has blessed in the area of finances. Don't you be prideful. Oh, I wish I could talk to somebody here. Amen. And that come when we have these sessions available to you. Amen. Amen. So we want you to be here. We want you to be an active participant in these ministries. God gave us these ministries for a reason. And so I'm excited about what God is doing. Thank God for Elder and Sister Parker. We are in the process now of restructuring and reorganizing our youth ministry. So next week, Pastor, who's singing? The pastor's choir. Next Sunday, they're going to sing. The pastor's choir is going to sing. We put the youth ministry under construction. All right, for a couple months, we're going to work on our entire youth ministry and the choir, and we're looking to relaunch sometime in April. And so, parents, we want you to get your young people involved. Amen. And so we're in the process of doing that right now. Amen. And so God has given us a vision that we need to have a separate young adult ministry. And it's going to be called YAF. That's for Young Adult Fellowship. And we prayed about who would be the leaders of that ministry. And Elder Lloyd Ace Lumpkin and his wife, Sister LaShawn. Come on, let's praise God for them. Come on, we can do better than that. Amen. They are going to oversee that ministry. And so I want them to come now. I want to pray for them. Amen. I want to pray for them now. Our pastors and elders, come on, let's pray for them. And let's lay our hands on them. Amen. I already feel revival happening in our, amen, young adults right now. Amen. I sense a great move of God and a great harvest. I believe that God's going to use this husband and this wife. Amen. And this ministry. Amen. If I'm not mistaken, the launch date is Friday, April the 7th. Amen. And all of you that are ages 19 to 35, we want you to come. Amen. And be an active participant in this ministry. You'll hear more about it later. Amen. But we thank God for them. Amen. They are Bible way all the way. Amen. And of course, he is from Atlas Road, and she grew up here. So the pastors are going to anoint them, and we're going to lay hands on them and their children, that the Lord will cover them, bless them, hallelujah, as they oversee the ministry. Will you stretch your hands this way? Most gracious and eternal God, our Father, we thank you, Lord, for the Lumpkins. We pray right now, Lord, that you would anoint them for service as they minister to the young adults. Father, we pray right now that nothing will be lacking. We pray right now, Lord, that you would give them anointing, give them vision, hallelujah, to touch and impact young people's lives. We pray right now, Lord, that every need in their lives will be met, that your blood will cover them, and that your power will prevail. Touch their bodies and keep them fit for their assignment. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray right now, hallelujah, that your will be done in them and through them. Have your way in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless their little ones and cover their family in the name of Jesus. We pray right now, Lord, as they take care of your business, that you would take care of theirs. Meet every need in their homes, that your name will receive glory. And Father, we thank you for the next harvest, hallelujah, of young adults. And we praise you right now for it in Jesus' name. Come on, everybody, put your hands together and give God a praise right now. Come on, somebody, give God praise. Come on, turn around and face the congregation. By the way, give God a praise for our Young Adult Fellowship Ministry Directors, Elder Lloyd and Sister LaShawn Lumpkin. Come on, let's praise God for them. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Let the church say amen. 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 All right. God bless you. Amen. Now, shall we all stand? Only have a few minutes. Shall we all stand? First Samuel chapter number 17. First Samuel chapter number 17, verse 32 down to verse 37. No, I'm sorry. Let's go to verse 29 down to verse number 37. All right? Y'all got it? All right. 1 Samuel 17, 29 through 37. Y'all got it? All right, let's read together. And David said, "What have I now done? Is there not a cause?" And he turned from him toward another and spake after the same manner. And the people answered him again after the former manner. And when the words were heard, which David spake, they rehearsed them before Saul, and he sent for him. And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight this Philistine. And Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he a man of war from his youth. And David said unto Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear, and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him, and smote him, and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, and smote him. The armies of the living God. David said, look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, you can't conquer what you don't confront. You can't conquer what you don't confront. Just very quickly, just let me define. To conquer something means that you have successfully overcome it. That's what it means to conquer. You know, we're very, we understand clearly the scriptures that said, nay, in all things, we are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ that loved us. You got to understand who you are in God. Because you really need to understand that you're not just a conqueror, you're more than a conqueror. You are a super victor. Question that I have for you this morning is that how can you lose with God on your side? If God be for you, who can be against you? I just want to help y'all this morning. No weapon that's formed against you shall be able to prosper, and every tongue that rises against you shall be condemned. You are a winner and not a loser. You are above only and not beneath. You are the head and not the tail. That's what it means to conquer. But that's all right. But sometimes we are not willing as people of God to confront the enemy. Scriptures are very clear. It says the wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous are as bold as lions. That in order for you to conquer something, you have to confront it. And to confront something means that you deal with it face to face. It's face-to-face combat. And sometimes, I don't know if you know, you got to get up in the enemy's face and tell the enemy to back up off you. I've come to encourage somebody today to tell you that you don't have to be afraid of no devil nowhere, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You got to understand who you are in God. How many of you know that because God is on your side, you cannot lose? The enemy cannot get victory over you because God has already gotten the victory for you. Our scripture this year is, thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. As long as I've got Jesus, I've got the victory. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. And so let me get to the story. It's very powerful here because we see David talking back, amen, to the enemy. And it's very important that we understand how he got here. Because if you read 1 Samuel, we will understand that Israel wanted a king. They wanted to be like other nations. And that's why you got to be careful and not be like other people, but be who God created you to be. We're so busy trying to be like other folks, but you don't know what it costs other folks to be who they are. So you better be who God created you to be. And so I've decided that I'm going to be me because everybody else is taken. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So I'm going to be who God created me to be. And so you get in trouble trying to be something that you were not created to be. And so they wanted a king, and God granted them their request. Of course, it was Saul that would be chosen as Israel's first king. Bible says that he had reigned 1 year, and when he had reigned 2 years, Samuel told him that he was coming at a particular time to offer up the sacrifice. The Bible gives us the information that it would be one Saul who would offer a burnt offering, who would assume the role of a priest. How many of you know that you got to stay in your anointing and what you've been anointed to do? Oh, y'all quiet here. Can I get some help on this side over here? Stay in your anointing. Do what God has called you to do. Lord Jesus, help me here. Whole lot of folks trying to be the pastor, but God is anointing you for the door. Lord Jesus, help me here. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Be what God called you to be. And so he assumes the role of a priest, and just as soon as he ends the sacrifice, here comes Samuel and said, "What hast thou done? Thou hast done foolishly. Thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord. And seeing that thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord, God has rejected you over reigning over Israel." He said he would have established your kingdom upon Israel forever, but now your kingdom shall not continue. Let me stop right here to tell you, how many of you know that you've got to do what God told you to do and do only what he told you to do? What was interesting was the fact that God would have established his kingdom upon Israel forever. That's why you got to be careful with the decisions that you make, because the decisions that you make not only affect you, but they affect other people. And so now God rejected him, and then Samuel will give the information that God have sought after him a king after his heart, and he shall be captain of his people. Of course, he would be speaking of one David. And when we get to chapter number 16, when God sends Samuel to Jesse's house, he said, "I want you to anoint whom I name thee." And it would be Samuel that would cause that would go to Jesse's house. But God asked him a question: "How long are you going to mourn, seeing that I've rejected Saul over reigning over Israel?" Now understand that Samuel is not the only one that's being asked that question. God is asking you a question this morning: how long are you going to mourn over something that God has already spoken over? Hallelujah, hallelujah. How long? And so now he says, if Saul hears this, he's going to kill me. I've come by to tell you this morning, when God has called you to do something, you better stop worrying about people and what they think, because you've got to answer to God. I wish I only got a few folks this morning, but if I can go with the five, y'all come on with me. You got to do what God has called you to do, whether folks like it or not. Can I talk to somebody who's been anointed to do something? Oh, my God. And you know God has called you to do it. You can't worry about. Oh, my God. Hallelujah. You can't worry about, because nobody can serve God and be a man pleaser. Oh, my God. Because I'd rather go to heaven by myself than to bust hell wide open with a lot of friends. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He said, and I'm trying to help the leaders this morning, whatever God has told you to do, you do what God has told you to do. Because at the end of the day, you got to answer to God. Hallelujah. Oh my God, hallelujah. Help me, Lord. This ain't going so well. Thank you, Jesus. Help me, Lord. So now here it is that he sends Saul to anoint Israel's next king. And when Samuel gets to Jesse's house, he would cause his sons to pass before Samuel. And certainly Samuel, looking for kingly deportment, would look at one Eliab and said, "Surely the Lord's anointed is before me." God has to tap him on the shoulder and says, "No, I have rejected thee, for man looketh on the outward appearance, but God is looking at the heart." I've come by to tell everybody here this morning, you're going to miss it every time looking for kingly deportment, because I've come by to find out that God's anointing somebody that don't look like you, that don't wear it like you, but yet God still has his anointing. Jesus on them. And so he says, surely he was confident. God had to tap him on the shoulder and said, "I've not chosen him." Then all of his sons go by Samuel, and he said, "None of these are the one. Are these all your children?" He said, "There is yet the youngest, who's out in the field with the sheep." Here it is, young David, who's out in the field, who has not
only, he not only does he love God, but he has developed a passion for God. And there are some of us that are here this morning that didn't wait till we came to church to sing God a melody. We didn't wait on the praise team. We wasn't waiting on the deacon to do the morning's prayer. But before we stepped out of bed this morning, we said, Lord, I want to thank you for another day that you've kept me. And Lord, whatever you want me to do today, give me the power to do it, because I want to be in your will. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And the Bible says that they go and get David and they anoint David as Israel's second king. Understand now that David now has been anointed, but he has been anointed privately. Oh my God. His public coronation doesn't come for some years later, but he's anointed in private. I've come by to tell you today that there's some folks that are anointed that we don't know are anointed. There's some folks that are anointed that don't have a microphone in their hand. Oh my God. But get in trouble and need somebody to pray for you. They'll pray the demons off of you. They'll pray cancer. Oh Lord Jesus, help me here. I found out that there's some folks that are anointed, but they anointed privately. And so now David is anointed privately, but he's anointed in the midst of his brothers. And the Bible says that now the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. Oh my God. Here it is now. Saul is on the throne, but he's not anointed. Oh my, I said, God, as long as I'm here, as long as I sit in this seat, I'm not moved by robes, I'm not moved by suits, ties, and cars, but Lord, as long as I'm in this seat, would you please keep your anointing on me? And if you ever have to choose between being anointed and appointed, always run with the anointing, because a title and a position ain't gonna change nobody's life. But how many of you know it's the anointing that makes the difference? Look at your neighbor and tell him, you can take everything you want, but you can't have my anointing. Oh my God. Yeah, somebody gave me this suit. Somebody gifted me this necktie, but my anointing I had to pay for. Is there anybody here this morning? The reason why you're anointed is because you had an experience with God. And folks don't understand why you're anointed. I just didn't get anointed when I stood up here, but I got anointed when I didn't know how my rent was going to be paid. I got anointed when my friends left me and talked about me. Oh my God, hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Everybody want a title, Pastor, but nobody wants to go through for the name of the Lord. If you're going to be used by God, you better believe that you're going to have to suffer, because everybody wants a title. Everybody wants to be known, but nobody wants to suffer for the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. My God, I thank God for the anointing. I had to pay for this anointing. Anointing doesn't come through the process of osmosis. I'm not anointed just because I come to church, but baby, I got anointed when I didn't know how I was going to eat. I got anointed when I didn't have any money, and God made a way for me. Is there anybody here this morning that thank God for your anointing, that you came to know God when you were sick and didn't know how you were going to get well? And that's why folks don't understand why you praise God the way you praise God. It's because God was there for me. Oh my God, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so now he says, look, they anoint David privately. The Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. And now it is now Saul now who is troubled by an evil spirit. And it would be Saul that would tell his messengers, find somebody who is skillful. Oh my God. God and anointed. Oh my God. Here it is, young David now. Not only is he, oh my God, a shepherd, but he is an anointed musician. There are some of us that God has gifted us with more than one gift. I wish I could talk to somebody here. The Bible says that David comes and plays the harp and he soothes the evil spirit of Saul. The Bible says, oh my God, the Bible says that now his brothers follow Saul to the battle, but David goes back and serves his father. Oh my God, y'all help me this morning. I'm preaching to myself. I've come to find out that there are a whole lot of people that after they get anointed, they don't want to serve anybody. They want to be served. But I want to talk to some people that will not allow your title to stop you from serving. Lord Jesus, help me here. After he gets anointed, he goes back to serve his father. I wish I could talk to somebody here that don't mind being anointed and a servant. I've come by to tell you, just in case you didn't know, that not only was Jesus the Savior, but he was a servant. David goes back to serve his father. And as a result of him going back to serve his father gives him the instructions to take these cheeses to your brothers. I gotta fast forward. We gotta get out of here. And now it would be David who obeys his father. If you're going to be a conqueror, if you're going to do the will of God, you've got to learn how to obey your father. Lord Jesus, help me here. Help me here. The Bible says now, when we get to chapter 17, that Israel is on one side and the Philistines are on the other. And there's a valley in between them. And they would do what they would call pitching. And what that is, in pitching, it was different. I wish they would fight wars like this now. They would choose one man to fight a man from the other army. And whoever won the battle would be considered the winner of the war. It would be one Goliath who is over 9.5 feet tall, whose armor weighs more than 150 pounds, who sends a challenge to God's people to say, choose you a man and let him fight me. And if he kills me, the Philistines will serve you. But if I kill him, you will serve us. The Bible says that none of them said a word. I'm trying to figure out, how can God be on your side and you allow the enemy just to say anything to you? Is there anybody here this morning that has matured and grew up in God, that have found out that if the enemy hollers at you, you better learn how to holler back? There's some of you that are facing situations this morning and you're too quiet. I don't see how you can call yourself a child of God and not say nothing back to the enemy. But I believe there's some people that's being raised up right now that have learned to talk back to the enemy and tell the enemy, you can't have my children. I wish somebody here this morning would hear this word. You can't have my family. I'm not always going to be like this because God is my healer. Is there anybody here this morning? I'm getting ready to go to my seat. Tell your neighbor, learn how to holler back. When the enemy tells you you're going to be broke, tell the enemy he's a liar. For my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. I'm going to my seat. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, you can't conquer what you don't confront. Stay with me. The Bible says that now when David gets in the camp, Goliath sends out the same challenge, but this time the right one heard him. He said, choose you a man and let him come out and fight me. David asked the question, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he would defy the armies of the living God? David said, I will go out and I'll fight that joker. I might be small in stature, but my God is big. Look at your neighbor and tell him, confront it. Oh my God. The Bible says that David said, that his words were rehearsed before Saul. And Saul says, you are no match for him. He was trained as a champion from his youth. And I've got to give the Philistines credit because they trained up a champion. And by the way, the Lord is saying that it's time for us to train up some champions. Oh my God. The Bible says that now Saul says, you're no match for him. David said, hold on, wait a minute. I've got to give my testimony. He said, I want to thank God for being here tonight. I give reverence to the pulpit. Thank God for Apostle Silver. We give honor to the elders. He said, it was a day when I was tending to my father's sheep and a lion and a bear came and took one of my father's sheep, and I smote both the lion and the bear. And the same God that brought me through that is the same God that's going to bring me through this. There's somebody here this morning. The Lord sent me here to tell you, the same God that made a way for you before is the same God that's going to make a way for you again. I don't care what your giant is, you've got to confront it before you conquer it. Look at your neighbor and tell him, confront your giant. David's giant was Goliath. Your giant may be a cigarette. It may be a bottle of liquor. I don't know what your giant is. Your giant may be crack. For some of you, it may be a woman. For others, it may be a man. But you got to confront it before you conquer it. David said, Goliath, I see you might be big, but my God is bigger. And he goes to the brook and gets 5 stones. I gotta go to my seat. Why did he get 5 stones? Because God will always equip you with more than what you need to defeat your enemy. I'm quitting. David goes to the brook. He gets 5 smooth stones and a slingshot. Here it is, Goliath. It stands over 9.5 feet tall. David's giant was 9.5 feet tall, but your giant may be 5'2". Your giant may be 6'1". It may be a corona. Oh, Lord Jesus, help me. Can I talk to y'all over here? It may be some Moet. Oh, Lord Jesus, help me here. Some Wild Irish Rose. Your giant may be pornography. But you will never conquer it if you don't confront it. Here it is. And what Goliath represents, Goliath represents a demonic attack. Because see, the enemy wants to intimidate you. But how many of you know God have not given us the spirit of fear, but of love and power? See, God doesn't want you to allow anything to disturb your mental calm. And we allow circumstances to manipulate our peace. My grandfather preached a message, why pray when you can worry? Learn how to give it over to God. David's response to Goliath, he said, you come at me with your sticks, and he said, but I come in the name of the Lord. Here it is, little David, a little shepherd boy, conquering
a 9.5-foot giant. He got 5 stones. Some say Goliath had 4 brothers. So he was prepared. But to me, the stones symbolize that God will give you more than enough. Now here it is. The Bible says that David gets the slingshot and he slings the stone at Goliath. The Bible says that the stone sunk into his forehead, which means that he got hit hard. And it would seem like to me, Elder, that Goliath would have fell on his back if it sunk in his forehead. But the Bible says that Goliath fell on his face to the ground. What am I trying to say to you? The enemies that set traps for you and thought that they were going to kill you, God's allowing your enemies to fall flat on their face. And what David does, it gets gruesome here. He takes the enemy's weapons. He takes the enemy's weapon. He goes to Goliath and he takes his sword. Good God Almighty. And what he does, he takes Goliath's sword and cuts Goliath's head off. You can't play with the enemy. And David takes the head of Goliath and goes to the gates of the city to send a message, just in case anybody else want a buck. The thing that you thought was going to kill me, I have already conquered it. But in order for you to conquer it, you got to confront it. And you got to be careful that while you're confronting it, you got to be careful of the voices that you're listening to. Oh, y'all don't hear me here. Because here it is, Saul is trying to put his armor on David. You can't fight your battles with everybody else's weapons. Oh, y'all better help me here. I quit. I promise. I'm done. I promise. I had a coworker, Johnny. Johnny and I had the same problem. He told me, I got a problem with my wife being on time. I said, I got the same problem. Notice I'm looking at y'all. I said, well, what do you do? He said, we were at a place. I told her I wanted to leave at 10 o'clock. She wasn't ready. I left her. I said, I ain't going to try that because I ain't sleeping outside on the front porch. You can't fight your battles with everybody else's weapons. You got to ask God for instruction and divine guidance and divine direction. But whatever your giant is, you can conquer your giant. But in order for you to conquer it, you've got to confront it. And then after you confront it, you got to fight it. Listen, as long as you live, you're going to have to fight something. Come on here. It's a fight to the finish. Paul said, I fought a good fight. Put up a good fight. Don't you let the enemy hoodwink you and keep you in the same place and stop you from maturing in God. Come on, we got all of this power. And we talk about we got this Holy Ghost, we running around doing cartwheels and everything else. But we can't conquer a cigarette. I know it's a process. But ask God to help you. Come on here. Help me here. Somebody said, no, you don't understand, Bishop. The TV got me. Learn how to use the remote. He said, say that.
I'm finished. I pray you got something from the word. But you cannot conquer what you don't confront. Come on, somebody praise God for the word. Come on, somebody praise God for the word. Come on, somebody bless the name of the Lord. I don't know why God has me here. There's somebody here having a difficulty in your marriage.